Hi, welcome. This is Underground. Cradle is the name of the episode, season one, episode seven. We got a little music in the background. Okay, we got some activity. So the episode opens with the making of Nico wafer candies. It closes with TR telling his daddy that Sam has run off, and he tells on TR tells on Sam because he went to tell James that they're brothers forever and give him candy, some Nico wafers. And James, who has started as a boy and turned into, if not a man, certainly he has had some new experiences, tells him, "I don't want any of your candy." And we discover in this episode, I guess the main highlight, or for me, or one of the main highlights, is that James is definitely a child of Ernestine. So, if you want to hear more about my recap and review of Season 1, Episode 7 of Underground, stick around. Welcome. Thank you for rate, commenting, and subscribing. So let's get into it. Again, the episode is called Cradle. It focuses on the children. This was, I think, just my favorite episode, although each one, as I'm going back through them again for the millionth time, has something in it that I really love. I say a lot. We start with James. Things are different now, his mother has told him. When he says, "I don't have to wear," she says, "remember what I told you about the white folks and the two faces?" "Yes, mommy," something to this effect, he says. "We wear one mask for the white people and one mask for ourselves." And he says, "But I don't have to wear a mask with TR." And his mother and his brother, Sam, are getting him ready to go out into the field. They trying to give him all of the training, all of the information, all of the tools and resources that they can, because tomorrow morning he's going out in the field. So it's do or die time now. We don't have time to waste. You got to grow up, baby. We love you. He rubbed his salve on your hand. They trying to pour everything that they can into him. "But I don't have to play with TR. I don't have to be different with him. I can just be myself." They say, "Things are different now, baby." We see James out in the field, and we also see that Bill Meeks is back and better than ever. He wrapped the bandana around his neck. He's got a little bit of it, but that bandana is holding his throat in, holding the blood in, he holding them together. And he is back, and he is mad at Rosalie and anything connected to Rosalie. So he is ready to get James. And James's brother Sam is out in the field with him. He's no longer in the workshop, and he's trying to guide the brother. "Do this. Don't look at them. Don't recklessly eyeball." He don't use that language, but that's basically it. "Keep your eyes down and just keep working, baby. Keep working, baby." At the end of the day, during the day, Bill Meeks comes up to James and says, "Did your brother tell you what's gonna happen if you don't make weight?" And James is like, "No." And he just walks away. Bill Meeks does. But we know it's something bad if he don't make weight. So they waiting in line at the end of the day to weigh the cotton. I guess everybody has to weigh how much they pick during the day. And right at the last minute, Sam switches bags with James. James is in front of him. James takes Sam's bag up. It gets weighed. Bill Meeks is like, "This can't be right. You didn't pick this much." But he did. Sam tells James to go on. Then it's Sam's turn. And we know that Sam is about to get beat because he did not get weight. Weight was 300. And he has his little brother James's bag. And he got 225. So he has to take the lashes. He chooses to take the lashes for his brother. They trying to protect the boy. We go to a scene where we see James sleeping, laying in the bed. Ernestine and Sam are talking. They think that James is asleep, but he's listening to everything that they say. They're reviewing the day. Sam is reviewing the day and talking about it. As Ernestine is trying to nurse his wounds from getting beat for not picking enough cotton on the work camp, the torture chamber. And Ernestine tells Sam that he can't keep switching bags for James, that James has to grow up. He can't keep taking lashes for James. Sam is like, I can do it, because that's his little brother, and it's a hard world out there, and he doesn't want him to have to experience this new harsh reality that his mother has been trying to protect him from. But that's their world now. They talk about the influence that the Reverend Willowset has put on Tom Macon, and Sam, the older brother, asks his mother, Ernestine, is there anything that you can do to sway Massa? So it's I guess he knows, and probably other people know, that Ernestine is in a situation with Tom Macon, and she has some influence, and can she use that for the boy? And she doesn't really make any comment, but you can tell it's something, this her son knowing, it's just not a good situation for her. She ain't feeling good about it. She ain't proud or happy about it. She don't really like him asking her that question. This is a quote, I think, from Ernestine. She says, the world ain't gonna get easier, and we ain't helping them by keeping them soft. So James is listening to all of that. The next day we see him in the field, he's kind of got his groove. He's drinking the dirty water. The first day he ain't drink the water, because as Sam said, he's used to that clean water up in the big house. He's not used to this dirty water. But today Sam is drinking his water. He's got his groove. He's not Sam, but little baby Henry has got his groove. Baby James has his groove. And, you know, he's going. At the end of the day, they're in line. And Sam is behind his little baby brother James again. He's got his hand on James's bag, and he wants to take James's bag and do the whole switcheroo like he did the day before, but he just lets Sam go on ahead. He lets James go on ahead, and lo and behold, James has made weight. He's at 315, 310, something like that. Bill Meeks is pissed. This is your new minimum. If you make less than this, it's lashes for you. Lashes, stripes, it's stripes for you, he says. So we're surprised, we're shocked. We don't know how he did it, but he certainly looked like he had his groove. And then toward the end of the scene, and I don't quite understand why, but we see that in the first scene, his mother, when the situation opened, his mother was sewing knee pads into his pants, so that when he bent down to pick the cotton, he would have some cushioning, because it's apparently hard on your knees to be down on your knees all day picking cotton. So his mom was trying to help him and protect him the best way he can. He has taken that needle and thread, and he has sewn some dirt into the bottom of his bag. The very first day when he did make weight because Sam switched bags with him, the overseer, Bill Meeks, had checked the bag. This can't be right. He dumped all the cotton out. He's checking for rocks, trying to figure out what trickery this Negro was up to. So today, on day two, James has sewn dirt into the bottom of the bag, and he, you know, unsews the bag. He's taken the needle and thread that his mom used to sew the knee pads onto his pants. He's sewn dirt into the bottom of the bag to increase the weight of the bag in a subtle way. And we see him undo the dirt and spread the dirt around. So I don't know if he figures now he can make weight and he ain't got to worry about it. But I would have left the dirt in there. But okay, so that's James. So he's from boys to men. He ain't no man, but you know, he's been forced to live a man-like life at a very, very young age. Okay, So that's James. Then the next thing, was that James? I don't know why I can't remember that baby's name. James, baby James. And then we switch to Ben is the next young person that's focused on during this episode. And he's going to the asylum with August. Remember, at the end of the last episode, his mother had escaped. So they're going to investigate, find the mother, figure out what's going on. We hear the doctor talking while Ben is looking around. We find out that the mother is manic depressive. We found out that they've given her a lobotomy. Ben decides that he wants to see the room that his mother is staying in, that his mother was staying in, because as he's looking around, things are looking, he trying to figure this out. It's not looking good. The man is like, oh, the person who runs the insane asylum or medical facility or whatever, experimental facility, is like, no, little boy, you don't want to see the room your mother is in. Here, have some candy. And Ben knocks the candy out of his hand. I don't want no candy. And he wants to see his mother's room. They do go to his mother's room. All over the wall, she has carved, she has their words all over the wall that she's written. Ben realizes that these are the lyrics to every song that she has ever sung him. He lays down in her bed, which is on the floor. The room looks a hot mess. The people from the facility are like, well, the way the room looks is a reflection of her mind. Is she crazy? So the room looked crazy. August is kind of mad because he's been sending them all the money he had. And now he kind of feels like he's gotten bamboozled or hustled, like they haven't been giving her what he thought they were going to give her. But Ben lays down on the bed. He figures out his mother is out the window. That's the stage, you know, where she's gone. He's using his spidey senses, his tracking ability that his father is sending, has been teaching him in order to track his mother. He goes out into the fields outside, and sure enough, he sees his mother. To in his eyes, to him, she's an angelic vision of beauty and light, and she's singing and she's just surrounded by light. His father comes up and is like, whoa, you know, step back, hold on, let me go first. And we see what is actually going on. The mother is barefoot, she's dirty, she's a hot ass mess. But of course, it's really sweet that Ben sees her, you know, in that light, at least initially. The next time we see Ben, he's sitting, he's talking with his mom. Did you get my letters? She's kind of spaced out. Letters, huh? Who are you? Oh, I know who you are. You look just like your father, whatever. He's like, you know, do you remember Jay? Who's the enslaved African that they have? Well, Jay told me the story of the two wolves. Did he ever tell you that story? Is dad a good wolf or a bad wolf? And that's kind of the key, you know, moment of that interaction. The next young person that we encounter is Boo. She's running. Elizabeth is walking. We see the little girl looking at Elizabeth through some bushes. She's being hunted. She's being chased. We see some flashes of her father, Moses, being shot at, some fireworks. It's kind of unclear whether it's guns, fireworks, arrows, some rudimentary basic gun, some variation of a weapon that used to exist that doesn't exist now, but I think it's some kind of early gun. I don't know. Elizabeth talks to Boo through the bushes. I'm here to help you, little girl. I'm not going to hurt you. Come with me. Just as she's about to, you know, she's chatting with her, some people come up. Hey, have you seen a little nigger girl? Excuse my language. No, I haven't seen anything. I've just been walking by the water. Elizabeth, when they leave, Elizabeth takes Boo into the house. She runs a bath for her. Here's this theme of the bath coming up again. Before she can put Boo in the tub, Boo looks in the water, has flashes of her father being shot with the arrows, with the guns, whatever. She screams, Elizabeth, you don't have to get in the water. She bathes her, you know, just, you know, oh, she's so sweet and so tender with her and takes care of the girl and cleans her up, you know, sensitive to her pain, tells her she doesn't have to speak to her. She knows that there are things that she can't speak about, you know, that you can't really speak about. It's so dark in here. I have lights on. It's not totally dark outside, but it's so dark in here. So Boo ends up telling her her name. Boo, my name is Boo. She talks about her mother and the bad men getting her mother. They're playing with ribbons. Elizabeth asks her where she got the yellow ribbon. Again, the yellow ribbon is showing up. She tells her that she got it from Rosalie. And she talks about the bad men getting her mother and why didn't God help. I don't know if she uses the language of God, but why, you know, why did they get her parents? Why are these people getting her parents? Elizabeth kind of figures out through asking questions. Well, ask her, who's your master? Master Tom. Elizabeth, oh, Tom Macon. And little girl, yeah, Tom Macon. And, you know, Elizabeth realizes that that's her brother-in-law that was holding her captive. We see a shot of Moses with arrows in his back. So I assume that he has made his transition again. Rest in peace. Constable Kyle comes in and visits. We see that the baby girl Boo has been hidden under the floorboard. She's looking up. Constable Kyle is talking to Elizabeth. Well, are you here by yourself? Where's your husband? Well, why are there two teacups? Yes, I'm here along. Well, why are there two teacups? Oh, because sometimes when I get lonely. And then he sees, he already knew the little girl was there. And then he sees Boo. Boo screams, you know, Elizabeth brings her out. Why would your husband, Constable Kyle says, put you in this dangerous situation? If you were mine, I would never put you in this situation. I would protect you and all your secrets. And Elizabeth realizes that the man, she already know the man, you know, still wants her. And so she ends up telling Boo to sit there. She goes upstairs, has sex with the man. Boo is sitting there. While she's sitting there, she has a Nico wafer. She has some candy. I don't know if they were eating candy during their little tea party, but she has some candy while she's waiting for Elizabeth to come back. I don't know if she hears Constable Kyle leave or whatever, but she eventually goes upstairs. Elizabeth is sitting in the bathtub, and Boo comes up and starts to bathe her and soothe her in the same way that Elizabeth had bathed and soothed Boo. So that's that scene. Then we flash to Henry, and Henry is at some type of Indian camp. Henry, Cato, Rosalie, and Noah are at some sort of Indian camp. I don't know if it's a hostel for runaway slaves, black people, a runaway hotel. I don't know what the story is with that, but they're the only ones there, except for their host, who is kind of taking care of some business. And Henry, like a little boy, is following them around, a young man, he's 15. Well, how do you do this? How do you know that? How do they know how many? What are you doing with the crosses? What's this? So we find out that there's gun power. There's a system for how they turn the crosses to let the people know how many people, how many caskets to bring for the people. You know, there's a whole system. You know, Henry is following the person around. The person is telling him that they're working on building a tunnel because it's not so many people to help along this way. So they want to have a tunnel that people can access to move from space to space. And, you know, he's going to do some work on that now. Henry, well, when we leave, well, I'm, you know, I got work to do. You stay here. I'm a travel light. So Henry, you know, we see him kind of going back to camp, and everybody's in their world. Rosalie and Noah are flirting and laughing. And he goes up on Cato, who's his regular sweet and light self, when Henry finds him folding something up. Well, what's that? Why are you asking? Oh, you can't be with Noah and Rosalie because they're flirting and you trying to get up in my business. They grown. You don't know about being in a woman between. Anyway, Cato is being his self. But we have seen a glimpse of tenderness when he was folding up the cloth. The host says that the Patty Cannon gang is still looking for him. So again, that's mentioned again. We see Henry sort of go off. He's kind of lonely. He goes off back to where the crosses are. I don't know if he has left, because when they were traveling before, his host was telling them how to move so that you don't leave tracks. And I don't know if Henry, being, you know, a young man, a little boy, has done something wrong, but he's back. He's come back. He's bonding. Noah is like, where you been? You know, and They're bonding together. Noah has made some ink and or has had someone make some ink. He's going to put a tattoo on Henry's back because Henry has always wanted a tattoo like Noah. They talk about freedom and what name they're going to have. And Noah says he wants to have the same name that Henry has selected for himself. So they're a family. It's so sweet. He goes. He's sitting with Rosalie. Rosalie is cooking for him. We had found out earlier that Henry came from a breeding farm, so he doesn't have family. But he realizes and remembers, Henry does, that Rosalie left family behind. She says she's happy to cook for him because it reminds her of home. There's a shot, and I think that right at this moment, Noah gets shot. The people scream, Patty Cannon gang or whoever, you're surrounded, come out. You know, this is a warning shot. Henry is like, there's gunpowder. We got to get fire to the shack with the gunpowder. We can create a bomb. Noah tries to do it. He maybe that's when he gets shot. So Henry goes on ahead and does it. He gets shot and we find out later he gets killed. But he does create the explosion, which creates enough of a diversion to save the group, what's left of the group. And so the camp is compromised. That part ends with a big explosion. We see TR go to James's. The next scene. Dang, I'm at 20 minutes. Let's stop this and we're going to pick up in a moment because I don't know if I'll be able to record all of this.